Mr. Danielson will be filming us today. So thank you for being here, Bruce.
Item 24.
A resolution determining it advisable and to the best interest of the public to gratuitously convey without payment certain real property owned by the city.
Councilor Starr.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I don't think anybody's surprised by this. We've been talking about this issue for quite some time with some land that we own, the use in the future of land or the building at the Ice and Rec Center. In fact, I see former Councilor Litz in the audience, now our county auditor, started working on this many years ago when he served on this fine body. What we have tonight is a resolution that would convey this property to the Glory House to allow them to expand and to provide housing for those in need that have graduated from their program at the Glory House. We spend thousands of dollars providing rehabilitation for people, and as we've seen in our local media just in the last day, and a continued issue that we've had for some time, is providing affordable housing for people as they transition and change their lives from being incarcerated at one point or another. What we've done is this, we've decided as a council over the past years that we would probably never open this facility again as an Ice and Rec facility. I think this council has made that as a policy choice. And it's something that we've moved on. This piece of property allows the Glory House again to expand in a location that has access to transportation. It's a workforce development issue. People can that would be served by this potential buildings in the future and housing can ride a bicycle to work. They have access to public transportation, a bus. The zoning is appropriate for the type of facility that the Glory House would like to bring forward. So the bottom line tonight, what we're doing is starting step one of a three-step process that it would take to convey this land to the Glory House. Tonight we have a resolution before us that just basically states that we'd like to transfer this land at no cost to the Glory House to allow them to expand. We passed this resolution tonight. We still have to, as a group, to finish this would be to bring a second resolution declaring this property surplus. And then we would have an ordinance, a first and second reading for an ordinance to transfer it. And actually, as part of that ordinance, would have a purchase agreement or an agreement between the two groups, the Glory House and the City of Sioux Falls, as a way to the things that the expectations the city would have. It would also include a reversion clause, possibly, that would, if this doesn't move forward, or if any time in the future that it isn't moved forward for the use that we've intended as a council, it would revert back to the City of Sioux Falls. So there has been no discussion yet about how that agreement would be written. I think we can work with the administration to bring that forward and to find a way that's acceptable both to the council and the administration and the board of directors of the Glory House. All we're doing tonight is getting the process started, being able to have an open and frank discussion about this is something that possibly could move forward. One of the things that I did do, I spoke with Director Cotter, and he wanted me to make sure that I could convey this to all of us that Public Works is working with a consultant at this point to look at drainage to putting 49th Street through. That consultant is doing their work in March and will bring a report forward by the 1st of April. By passing this resolution tonight, we're not locked into anything other than starting the process to come up with a contract and a transfer. We will take several months to get that negotiated by the time it's acceptable to us as a body and acceptable to the Glory House. So with Public Works work that's going on, that shouldn't slow this down by any means. There have been a lot of people who've been part of this, and I thank them for that. We've had a lot of meetings. We've had a land use committee that the council has had. We had a informational meeting where we've discussed this item. We've had numerous meetings with the members of the administration, from finance to public works to planning. And I do, more than anything, want to thank Director Cotter, or not Cotter, but the director, our parks director, Don Kearney, has been an integral part of this process of bringing this forward. He graciously opened up the facility so we could tour, see what was going on, see how the building, to borrow a phrase, is very tired and past, would take a considerable amount to open the facility again as a hockey ice rink. But his department has been very gracious in moving this along, and I appreciate that, as well as community development. Director Ketchum has been very helpful in bringing forward some concerns, but at the same time, doing what's best for our community. And that's what the state legislature allows us to do by conveying this at no cost to the Glory House. It allows them to start a facility. We can work on things like workforce development. It meets so many different things. But really, the bottom line is it is going to give some individuals a chance to continue on their path to turning their lives around and becoming productive citizens of our city. And with that, I'm sure I've taken my 5 minutes.
Is there anybody in the audience who wants to speak to this item? Welcome.
Do I get five?
You get more than five.
Good evening. Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Council, for allowing me to be here. My name is Dave Johnson. I'm the Executive Director of the Glory House. I want to thank, first of all, the Council's willingness to meet with us to have some discussion on this. Our goal, and I say our goal because I have several members of our board here, our goal is simply to create an extension of a safe place for people to go on and be successful. Our clients, both men and women, come to our facility and they struggle. They struggle with addiction. Those that are there have mental health issues. Many of them do. They struggle with employment. They struggle with all the case management things that probably you and I might take for granted. But they struggle. What we find is that we can help them work on their alcohol and drug issues. We can help them with their mental health issues that go along with it. But when they leave Glory House, anywhere from that first 72 hours, that first 30 to 60 to 90 days is a critical time frame. They fall on their face sometimes. We want to create a facility or an apartment complex, somewhere where they can be connected to recovery services, have access to mental health care, have access to case management, continue their employment, because it really is a workforce development piece. We want to be able to provide a safe place. Our men and women are hungry for the opportunity. They are. And when, you know, we opened up tonight, we talked about marginalized folks. Well, you don't have to look very far to see somebody that's coming out of prison, that's trying to get a job. They're competing with people that haven't been in prison, with college degrees, and they sometimes need help. How are we going to keep them on the path if we spend this money to treat, unless we continue that continuum? That's really what we're talking about. Glory House has been in this community since 1968. Appropriately, it was named the Glory House because of the assassination of Martin Luther King. That's how it got its name. That's where it came from. So tonight we're here having this conversation because I think Roger Fredrickson and his friends of the Baptist Church saw a need to reach out to those marginalized folks. We want to do the same thing. We want to continue that progression. Glory House is accredited. We provide a great service with employment services. We help people figure out their lives. And they're the ones doing the hard work, but I think we have a responsibility too as citizens. And that's what I'm asking for, is that opportunity. We appreciate what the City Council does. We appreciate what you do, Mr. Mayor. But we think that this is a win-win, and this will bring back tax revenues. This will give families hope. And I think that's what we're in the business of. If we don't have hope, what do we have? And we want to have that opportunity to do so. I'm going to close. Some of you might have got nervous when you saw me bringing all this up, but I'm not going to read it all. And I haven't had a chance to really read through this. This is the Thrive report that you're all aware of. And I just found an executive summary, and it says, roughly two-thirds of very and extremely low-income families spend more than 30% of their monthly income on rent. And about one-third of those spend more than half their monthly income. Now, that's just for folks that are struggling with poverty. On top of that, put somebody that's also a felon. They can't go to some places and rent a place to live. We deal with some of the offenders that are really have not been the greatest citizens. But they're coming out. We're there to help them, and we want to help them continue this process. We'd like the support. We'd like to partner with the city. We think we can be good partners, and we'd like to move this forward. So please, I would appreciate your sincere consideration. Thank you.
Thank you, Dave. Folks, anybody else? Welcome.
Good evening, council members. Don Kearney with Parks and Recreation. Certainly, there's been a lot of dialogue and discussion about this particular project, but I think it's definitely was a surprise when we saw this on the city council agenda, and a surprise for many city directors, needless to say. As many of you probably already know, that we are using the building for storage for our Winter Wonderland displays, including our lights and garland, and we're also storing seasonal pool furniture in that location to keep it out of the elements. You know, since we essentially closed this facility, we've literally had dozens of requests and interest in this property for a variety of different purposes, whether it be adjacent property owners. Obviously, the Glory House was one of those, but multiple different folks that were interested in potentially securing this property. But the point being is that I think there's a high level of interest in whatever we do with this property, there'll be plenty of onlookers as to what happens in the future. As a reminder, this facility is still functional. It's available, and it could be used for ICE in the future. Anybody that's been out to the Ice and Rec, Shields IcePlex, November through March, I think would say that it's very much at capacity, and it's very much being well used, but certainly there's a lot of demand on that facility. And certainly from my perspective as the department that holds that asset, it certainly would be our hope that we could defer this item until other city departments have had an opportunity to be fully vet it and understand the complete proposal. So thank you.
Thanks, John.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the council, Tracy Turbeck with the Finance Office. And I am here to speak in opposition to the resolution and urge you to vote no on this particular resolution. And let me say at the outset that my opposition has nothing to do with the Glory House, as I'm certain that the services that they do provide are quite important to the constituency that they serve. They clearly have their mission to fulfill. The city has its mission to fulfill as well, and from my perspective, there appears to be very little, if any, overlap between those missions. There are many, as you know, many nonprofits in the community all doing very good work and providing valuable services, fulfilling their own missions. The city cannot reasonably donate taxpayer resources to all of these very worthy causes. This particular gift would be a significant investment of city resources. And I would ask, why should the city handpick this particular nonprofit, as worthy of an organization as it may be, to be the recipient of such a valuable piece of taxpayer-owned property? As you know, the city's resources are limited, and this is, in fact, a valuable piece of property. As you also know, for nearly a year now, we've seen the growth in sales tax revenues slow. Spending last year was reduced to compensate for that slower growth in revenue. The budget this year in 2017 is flat to last year's budget. Is now really the time to be giving away valuable city property? Is the highest and best use of this valuable city property truly fulfilled by giving it away? This hardly seems a prudent move for the city, from my perspective. The process to determine the long-term best use of this property ought to be much more deliberate. even more so than if the city were considering simply writing a check for a high six-figure range. Consideration also should be given to the future development of 49th Street, which will only increase the value of this property. The move to give this property away seems quite rushed. Let's take our time. Let's not make a hasty decision. After all, what is the hurry? And as Don mentioned, the city staff learned only late last week that this resolution would go on the council agenda tonight. That's certainly not the kind of effective, open, transparent communication that the council has tried to maintain with the administration in the past. And I would urge the council to vote no on the resolution. Thank you.
Good evening, council. I'm Mike Cooper with Planning and Building Services. And I just wanted to give a little more background on the discussion item tonight. And again, this came up at our last Friday briefing with a number of questions. And I've been involved in discussions about this over the years with Glory House, with council members. This exhibit that's up on the screen now shows you the concept of the extension of 49th Street that we've been talking about for a number of years that would go from Minnesota Avenue to Western Avenue. As Director Cotter indicated through Councilor Starr's briefing tonight, there's another step in this process that we're currently working on. Although this project has been on the planning stages for quite a few years, there's still property that we have not acquired, and we still don't have a final design of the street. And that's what we're working towards this April timeline, is to get a little bit of idea of what the actual street design might be, and including some of the drainage and other associated impacts might be with the construction of the 49th Street. The main reason that it has been held up historically is because we've gone back and forth with the South Dakota Department of Transportation about what's going to happen in the future to the Minnesota Avenue I-229 interchange, and how the 49th Street extension over to that street would potentially be constructed so that it functions properly. When the Costco store was announced over on Grange Avenue, there was discussions then about should we move ahead with at least portions of 49th Street from Grange over to Western. And I think the store has been pretty successful. But now we're at the stage that in our capital program in 2017 and 2018, we have about roughly $400,000 earmarked to continue to look at the design of the street and the land acquisition, or the right-of-way acquisition. With this exhibit, you can see that with the proposed alignment of 49th Street, there's going to be a triangle-shaped piece of land potentially just directly north of the Ice and Rec Center and north of Glory House. Again, we're not sure what the use of that land is going to be or what could be. And the study that Director Cotter is talking about, I think, will help us answer some of those questions. I know in the past I've been involved in discussions with Glory House about acquiring that future triangle and maybe putting their project there, and still making the Ice and Rec Center property available for some other future use. So what I'm talking about tonight, again, is we were caught off guard Friday morning about this, and I know that I've had meetings with other people over the months and over the years, so it's no surprise that Glory House has been looking at this area. But if there's no time sensitivity, that we have to make the decision tonight to at least make the commitment that we're going to do something with the Ice and Rec Center, I would think it would be prudent to at least wait at the least until the engineering study is done, which is only going to be another 30 to 45 days. And that will at least give us some more information about what's going to happen with the road design and what's potentially going to happen to the property around this area, because not only do we have to make a decision about the Ice and Rec Center, but there's going to be land all along that 49th Street corridor that we have to decide what's going to happen. So that's what I'm saying tonight is I think as a staff, we would prefer that at least we hold off until we get the engineering report so we kind of know what the parameters are going to be with the development of that property around the 49th Street corridor. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. Did anybody else want to speak about this? Welcome.
Your Honor, members of the council, my name is Jim Schmidt, 716 East St. Andrews Drive. Let me say thank you for your service. I represent the Glory House Board. I get the privilege of that. And I just want to emphasize, while I heard Mr. Turbeck and others talk about the timeline, the Glory House Board has spent considerable amount of time informally talking about this particular parcel of property and what it could mean for the individuals that we serve. In talking with Councilman DeStar, we found that this was the first step. This is a step that requires two other situations. And I'm prepared to tell you tonight that we are, our planning for the long range is that we would request, and we're certainly willing to work on any of the planning things that need to go on, and I understand the need to look at the drainage issues, look at 49th Street. But one of the things that I just wish to emphasize with you, by having this initiated thing begin tonight, we then will provide you with a comprehensive business plan, and I think that's only prudent on our part, a business plan that will include a purpose that we wish to have the land, our rationale. We wish to have the plan and show you the development that is necessary, but more importantly, we have to set in motion how we're going to finance all of this development that we would have, which would be basically housing. And housing takes time. If we are to do this, we have to look at the community foundation that the Chamber of Commerce has, and that takes from 2 to 3 years to even be considered for that. You've got tax credit situations that take a long time and a study to have this. And when you get the full report from the Thrive thing, that has some very startling information on affordable housing. And this only emphasizes what we're attempting to do. And the other thing I think that you would want to see would be a very schematic design, not only for the area, what it plans to look like, how it's going to fit in with this area, with the community, but also you would see the design of the building itself and how we put this together for those individuals out there. And that all will take, it's going to take some time, it's going to take some effort on our part to do this, but we have to begin somewhere. And that is what I view this tonight and what Councilman Starr, and I would encourage you for that support. Thank you very much.
Folks, anybody else want to engage the council on this particular topic? Welcome.
Scott Harrisman, Sioux Falls. I've talked about this before, but I've been familiar with the Glory House since I moved here 25 years ago. My first roommate was a private security guard. One of his clients was at Glory House, and I've had several friends who have worked at the Glory House. It provides a great service, and, these people need this. I'm not up here to talk about the moral responsibility of what we should do as citizens or as a city council. Economically, this reminds me a lot of the safe house where we put people who we were, how should I put it, scraping off the streets every weekend and spending lots and lots of taxpayer money, pulling them, paying for them to go to the ER when it was just much cheaper to house them. And I look at this in a similar light. I work with people that are from the Glory House, and the struggles that they have being a felon, no matter what that crime is, believe it or not, because a lot of renters don't really care. Once they only hear that you're a felon, they don't want to rent to you. And for them to find housing is one leap, a job is another leap, and then for them to find a decent place to live is even a farther advance. Most of these people get stuck a long ways from their jobs. They got to ride a bus a long ways. They're not close to transportation like the Glory House is. And what that does is cause stress, and these are people who are addicts that are already trying to get their lives back together, and what most likely happens is, not all of them, but a lot of them go back to jail, which in turn, as I said, costs us a lot of money. I think giving away a property that we don't use anymore is a very tiny, tiny, small price to pay for what we're going to save as taxpayers by keeping these people out of jail. Thank you.
Thanks, Scott. Tim, before you come on forward, sir, if I could just ask the folks in the audience, if you're going to have extended conversations, just go out to the hallway, if you don't mind, just to have some respect for the folks that are up here speaking. Really appreciate it. Tim, welcome.
Tim Stanga. I used to deal with troubled youth. You would deal with kids that are 13, 14 years old that came out of a bad household. I'd take them up to my cabin every weekend. These kids were great kids. But when the court takes them out of their house, they go into a facility and they have to live until they're 18, 19 years old. There's no place for these kids to go. But one thing I always told these kids, I said, get an education. Get a GED. I said, because what? That is going to help you. I have a cousin that's in prison right now. One thing I told him, take advantage of any kind of education in the prison system that you can, because of one reason. It's going to help you outside once you get out. To this day, he has taken two courses between his electricians and his plumbing. The guys that I dealt with at when they were 14, 15 years old, these kids now are 28, 29. They still call me. They let me know how their lives are going. And when these kids are in trouble, when they see themselves sliding, there's nobody for them to talk to. But they call me. Why? Because I was there for them. They had some kind of a role model. And that's what these kids are lacking right now. And is the Glory House a bad spot? No, because I had an uncle that was in the Glory House. I knew Pastor Fredrickson. I grew up with him. He was my pastor. Great guy. My uncle was at the Glory House for some time. But alcohol, he couldn't give it up. And the Glory House couldn't help him. He ended up dying of alcoholism. But I think we got to look at a broader picture. I think our kids, we got to work on our kids too. Because once they get out of the system, 9 times out of 10, they're going right back in the system. So if we're going to look at giving people help, I think we got to look at kids too. Thanks.
Thanks, Jim. Appreciate it. Welcome.
C.R. Broussard, Sioux Falls. I think it's a wonderful idea. And this goes back to the hotels and the motels with so many people on parole that's always going back a week to 2 weeks later. So when people get out of prison, they stick them in motels and hotels and they can't be monitored. I heard that the Glory House is not like the Arch House, and I hope it is not. The Arch House is some different program that's out of this world. If the Glory House is very successful, they have low crime there, the police is not called there, and these people can get help, and these people can go to the Glory House, have an apartment of their own, work for it. That is wonderful. This idea is what we need to get people out of these hotels and motels and to get them in a good environment, not to be repetitive into the prison system here. So I say I'm not for giving away properties because I don't like giving stuff away. But if y'all can come up with a little price value here, that would be great, $100, $200, $300 or whatever is valued at. But I think it is a good program, and I think that not only should we work on the Glory House, but we need to work on the Arch House also, because the Arch House is really getting bad, and it and the people that's at the Arch House is really going downhill on these street corners here at on Duluth Avenue here. So I just wanted to, you know, y'all know how I feel about the crime here, but if the Glory House can help to get these people off the streets and get productive, I'm all for it. So thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. Folks, did anybody else want to engage the council before I go to them? Mm-hmm. Councilors? Councilor Staley?
First of all, I would like to say a big thank you to Councilor Starr, because I know he has spent many, many hours working on this. And so I'm bravo to you. The county is taking the bulk of handling people who are underprivileged, people who are struggling. The county is dealing with these people, whether it be through the jail system, social services. We don't have that responsibility as a city. And when we're talking about allocating resources to nonprofits, I want to herald back to last fall when we started on the council. And we gave a nonprofit called Forward Sioux Falls a 5-year contract equaling $2 million. So we do give money to help nonprofits. I think this is a wonderful thing that we're doing. I'm totally behind it. We can do this. We can make it happen. And we just, we had an arrangement with Elmwood Golf Course where we let them have some of our land. I mean, we're doing these kinds of things all the time. And when it comes to buildings that we're not using, I'm going to say when the park department moves into the new administration building, we need to look at selling that existing property. We have some valuable things within our possessions that if we need the income, we need to be looking at giving that to the back to the public sector, or excuse me, private sector. So anyway, I just wanted to say thank you to Councilor Starr.
Councilor Silver.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. It's in my understanding this resolution basically just starts the discussion, and I do believe it's one that we need to get to and have. As Mr. Schmidt said, we have to start somewhere. When you do talk about gifting land, I know it is a slippery slope. What could it lead to here or there? I think it's going to have to take, it depends on each situation. But I know whether a gift is the answer here, or maybe when it all comes down to it, maybe it's a sale or transaction with very favorable terms, I don't know. But I just know that when you look at the combination of the location of this building and the cause involved, I think we definitely need to sit down and start looking at some options, and we need to start looking now. I know I've heard on one hand it's kind of sudden, it's come up, but I also know I've heard that discussions about this particular topic have been going on for years, so let's set a timeline and start talking about it. Thank you.
Councilor Mock?
Thank you, and I would agree with Councilor Selberg for the second time tonight. I'm surprised that staff is doing this, oh, we're so shocked, routine, because I know that you're not. This is something that's been going on for a long time, and Councilor Starr just had the guts to get us off the dime. And that's really all this move does, is it just gets us off the dime. It's time for us to say to the Glory House folks that, you know what, we're committed to this or we're not. And it's time for them to go to their donors and say, are you committed to this or not? And is this something that we're going to move forward with? And we might get down to that second or third step, because it is quite a long process. I mean, for us to defer this now or to put it off for now, just extends this already long and involved process. But if we get down this road a little ways and their donors say, you know what, we're not with you, you're on your own, it may just fall through the cracks and the city has to come back and deal with it. But I think the thing that we need to understand as a council, and Councilor Staley referred to it, is that there aren't very many things that we can make a huge difference in the lives of the people that live in this community. And this is one of them, where we have spent so much time in the last 7 years that I've been on this council, we've spent so much time making sure we have crime-free housing, that our neighborhoods are safe, that places are, you know, that we know exactly where every sex offender lives in this town and all of those things. And what we've done is we've created a box. and that box is right down there by the Glory House. It's really the only place where these folks can find a decent place to live, a decent place where they've got some support, where they can catch the bus to go to work. And this is one of our opportunities, one of those rare opportunities on a city council where you get to make this level of difference in the lives of the people that live in this community, and I just ask you all to support this first vote in a long process.
Yes, Councilor Chair Ruffin.
Boy, I get put in another situation here tonight where I think we have, while this is a really feel-good resolution that I think needs to be worked on very strongly, it appears to me we really haven't, it hasn't been vetted enough, that we really need to work with this. While Councilor Starr has visited with all these people, Ed, and got them into a room and said, you know, let's work this out and let's see what we can do. It's been a lot of visiting and not enough, maybe not enough vetting. I support the idea. I think it's a great idea. I think it's something we need to look at, not to do right now, and to make sure that, and to just move it forward. You know, counselors, many of you are usually against spending any money, any extra money. Tonight, we've given away the extra cost of firemen, the extra costs of videoing, which we don't know what the costs are, and now we're talking about hundreds of thousands of dollars. Even though it's just a start, there's two more votes, it's more than that. It's a symbolic saying, let's just do it. And I think we need to put the brakes on here just a little bit. Nobody is saying no. I don't think anybody here is saying no, let's not do it. What we're saying is, let's vet it a little bit more, let's come back in 2 weeks and look at this again, and see what we can do and where we can go. So I would make a motion to defer this until February 7th.
There's been a motion to defer this till February 7th. Is there a second? That has failed for lack of a second. Anybody else want to? Yes, Councilor Neissert.
So I'll just throw out where I'm at with this. The first thing is, it's my belief that if we don't move this forward, we're not going to move anybody off the dime. This is just the first step in the process. We've talked about that. I just have to address a couple of things that I heard. I heard that there is apparently little overlap between the city's interest and the Glory House. You know, rising crime, recidivism, the lack of affordable housing. That's a huge interest in this city. It's a huge issue. It's not just a social problem, it's an economic problem. We might reopen this as an ice rink. I think we've had that discussion. I have to think the operating losses and opening up one sheet of ice at there is going to be perhaps more in 1 year than the cost, than the appraised value of this land. That we need somewhere to store Christmas lights, and therefore we don't want to address this problem. And as far as picking winners and losers, it's kind of interesting that a few years back when I was sitting in the audience, I didn't hear a lot of discussion from the administration marching up to talk about why we shouldn't pick winners and losers and giving $500,000 to a tennis facility. So we pick winners and losers all the time. So thank you.
Do we have a motion to yes, Councilor Starr?
Sorry, and I apologize, but I want to, I think Councilor Neissert, and we've kind of wrapped this up, and I appreciate that, but I would be remiss, one of the biggest proponents that's helped me along in this process, part of our staff who's been at all the meetings that I've been with and everyone, but the point I want to make more than anything else, we acquired this land from the Minnehaha Ice and Rec, I apologize, I get the name of the group, for $100,000 is what we purchased this land for. And the purpose was to do good for our community. We put the facility in a financial position where hockey and the figure skating associations could continue to do what they did. This land was acquired in this area, the box that Councilor Erpenbach talked about. Dr. Giebink, back in the 60s, acquired this land and had sold, shared, put it into, the whole intent was to provide for the public good. And I think we'd be remiss as a city if we looked at land speculation of what this could be worth someday, how to maximize profit on this this parcel or this piece of land. I think the purpose and the best thing that we could do for the citizens of Sioux Falls is to not find the best way to profit. The best way to profit from this land is by continuing to help people who are at the Glory House. I'm going to skip, you know, answering some of the other objections, but give us a chance to move forward. And I wasn't going to say this, and I have to. Community development asked for 6 to 8 weeks back in October. We've sat on this. We've waited patiently. We've looked for a deal to work with the county that was never there. You know, but it was a chance to hold on to this for a couple more weeks. It was a chance to maybe he'll go away or the council will go away. And tonight we have a chance to do the right thing and move forward. I think there was a quote from Martin Luther King yesterday. It's always the right time to do the right thing. And this is one of those times.
Councillor, did you have another comment?
No, it seems like I don't want to say I'm losing this, but that's fine. I'm not, as I said, I'm in favor of doing something with the Glory House. But I think let's look at this one more time from the standpoint of gifting. Councillor Starr, you and I have talked about other options. According to this, there is no other option. It has to be gift. So I would entertain or offer an amendment that in the second paragraph we add after the phrase in the that's in the first sentence, without payment, I would add or sell. We may need to sell this for a buck. We may need to sell this for 10 bucks. We may need to sell it for $100,000, what we bought it for. But by not doing that, we're not leaving ourselves open to any other options whatsoever. And I don't think that's fair to the people of Sioux Falls. So I would offer that amendment.
So the amendment is you're adding the words or sell after without payment?
Correct.
I'll second the motion for the... He made the motion. I'm seconding his motion to add those words.
We have to... let's have a motion to approve this first. Councillor Starr, do you want to make that?
I would move to approve the resolution.
Second, Erpenbach.
And a motion to approve it has been seconded. You'd like to make an amendment to add the words or sell after without payment?
Correct.
Is there a second on that?
Second that for conversation.
Go ahead.
My question then is for Attorney Fifley in terms of he is just adding those two words. I know that there are several places where it says gratuitous, giveaway, free. Even the title is gratuitously convey without payment. Can we make an amendment like this and imply that we know we need to go in and change it in all of those locations?
Under state law, you have two options. You either have to sell this property for within 90% of its appraised value, or you can gratuitously give it away, in other words, without payment, and that's pursuant to South Dakota Codified Law, Chapter 6-5. We would need to change several of the references throughout the resolution to make it what Councillor Rolfing wants as far as adding that. I would just add that in terms of the findings that you are making as a council, the resolution has two parts. You are making findings that this property is not held for a public use or is about to be abandoned for public purposes, and you are making a specific finding that it's advisable and to the best interest of the public to gratuitously convey without payment all or a portion of this property. So I just want to make it clear legally that this chapter 6-5 says you can do this, however you have to make these findings via this resolution. So this is a major step in terms of conveying this property gratuitously. So
if I can, Mr. Mayor, and yes, for Attorney Fifley, my question is in regards to your comments as well as the appraisal. We've heard numbers thrown around, oh, this property, once that road goes through, it's $600,000 to $1 million. When the appraisal's done, I'm guessing that it needs to be an actual bank appraisal done through the process. It's not just, hey, I think that this is worth this amount of money. How does that work? And then my second question is, can this resolution be amended down the road? Attorney Brown, thanks for being here. I appreciate you. bailing us out on some of these questions.
Sure. Danny Brown, City Attorney's Office. If an appraisal is going to be done, it has to be a certified appraiser appraisal.
Okay.
A bank can do appraisal for finance purposes for Glory House, but for our purposes, we'll have to hire an appraiser to do it.
Okay. And then my other question is can this be this resolution be amended down the road? Say the amendment does or does not pass, regardless, if the resolution here, number 24, does pass, can we come back and amend it in 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, and add this at that time?
I mean, you could, but you also need to remember, you can always sell real estate for 90% of fair market value. So whether this resolution says you can or can't, 4 months down the road, if you wanted to sell it, you had an appraisal, you could sell it for 90% as long as you went through the publication process.
Thank you.
Yeah.
There is a motion to amend this particular item. Yes, Councilor Neisser.
So to clarify the first part of what the city attorney said, do we do in making the statement that could you read the first part again? I think that was really the key part that I'd like to ask.
The two parts, Councilor, that you are making resolution on tonight or findings is that this property is not held for a public use or is about to be abandoned for public purposes. That's pursuant to SDCL 6-5-2. And the other paragraph under the therefore be it resolved is that's also under the same statute. It is deemed advisable and to the best interest of the public to gratuitously convey without payment all or a portion of the above described real estate.
So the first part, can that be repealed 2 months down the road and unring the bell and say it's that we think it's
the whole thing?
I think Attorney Brown has already addressed that. Certainly, you can come back later and decide you want to sell this based on some appraisal. But certainly, I just wanted to clarify for tonight that you are making two specific findings that are required under that state statute. So it is more than just starting that conversation. You are making those findings. You can go back on those findings later, but those are two findings you're making tonight.
Okay, thank you.
Not the right time.
It's been a motion to amend this item to add the words or sell after the words without payment. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
No.
Erpenbach?
No.
Neitzert?
No.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Selberg?
No.
Star?
No.
Staley?
No.
That has failed 1-6. There is now a resolution as it's written in front of us. If there's no further discussion, roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Neitzert?
Yes.
Rolfing?
Yes.
Selberg?
Yes.
Star?
Yes.
Staley?
Yes.
That's fast. 7-0. Could you put your cookies down, please? Security, escort this gentleman out, please.
Come on, Soda Pop, let's go.